Rai, Deputy Librarian Vishwabharati. Welcome you, the scholars and colleagues, to this session of webinar. In my presentation, I shall try to give ideas on what is research, why it is being conducted, systematic steps in research, and criteria of a good research. And finally, I shall try to give an insight into details discussion of research output in two segments. One is research paper and another is thesis. Obviously, it will be followed by interactive session so that it can be a two-way communication, not a one-way traffic. First of all, let us have an idea of what is research. Actually, research is a systematic approach towards purposeful investigation. So for conducting research, you must have some purpose. That may be research problem we intend to solve, or in social science, that may be hypothesis, which is tested through positive, negative, or null. So we must have a purpose, that is a purpose. And to fulfill the purpose, I mean, to fulfill the objective of research, we have had to systematic approach. So systematic approach to purposeful investigation may be termed as research. Research, again, is an activity to undertake generalizing fresh knowledge. So knowledge, not only by through research, we develop not only new knowledge, but it have to be generalized. That means it has to be implication in all other similar things. That is more important. Now let me give you a definition of Encyclopedia of Social Science. Quote, the manifestation of things, concepts or symbol for the purpose of generalizing to extend correct or verify knowledge, whether the knowledge aids in the construction of theory or in the practice of art. So it is a generalization. Again, this definition has three, four facets. That is a generalization, generalize the findings, creation or correct or verify new knowledge, generating new knowledge. And this knowledge must have help in the construction or aid to construction the theory or which has to be purpose. Now, again, it is an inquiry into the nature of the reason for and the consequence of a particular set of circumstances, whether these circumstances are experimentally controlled or recorded just as they occur. So again, in this definition, the set of circumstances is there. Those circumstances are being recorded through some parameters, through some research methodology, through some limitation or delimitation techniques. Those circumstances are controlled, result and obtained and record to given generalization thesis. Thus, research is to see what everybody else has seen and to think what nobody else has thought. Let me give you an example. Apples falls from the tree, that is an universal truth. But as soon as Isaac Newton saw it and gave the laws of gravitivity, that may become research. So everything, to see what everybody else saw that apple is falling from the tree, but Isaac, it thinks in otherwise, which nobody else has thought. That's why we got laws of gravitation. So research is creating new knowledge. What is the purpose of research? Research is creating new knowledge. It helps to create new knowledge. So now let me have an idea, what research helps? Research helps in finding answers to questions. Systematic approach for the truth and original information, even original information obtained through research. Research fulfills the thirst of knowledge of mankind. Scientific and systematic search for information on specific topic. So research helps in answer to many questions. Nowadays we are in the pandemic situation of corona. So globally research is being conducted on this particular topic. The answer is how to develop medicine for its preventive or curative part. That is the answer to question. Answer to question, here the question is the survival of mankind. So that is important. Again, for this, we have to have systematic search for the truth. That means what medicines are being implied, what are the outcomes of it, is there any negative or positive effects for it. So all systematic search, systematic recording of data, systematic recording of facts, systematic recording of information helps to develop the truth. And ultimately, it helps to generate new knowledge and information. And obviously, everything, all the questions are related around the man's thirst for knowledge. And that thirst for knowledge started from the date of the beginning of the civilization when Adam and Eve took food of grand bhikkhu. Now, let me give an idea about knowledge pyramid. That is important in the concept of research. In our school days, I think maybe 9 or 10 syllabus, we have an idea about ecological pyramid. That is grass at the bottom, then grasshopper, then snake, then eagle. So likewise, then this is called ecological pyramid. Likewise, in our knowledge domain, we have a knowledge pyramid. The base is data, upper rank is information, then knowledge, and ultimately wisdom. So data, what is data? Data is observed facts. That facts may be observed by through different methods, by going to the population, collecting data through questionnaire, participant observation, interview, many things. And processed data is information. When data are processed, that became information. And summation of many bits of information generates knowledge. Let me give you an example. For example, in a village A, 50% women are literate. Again, in a village B, 60% women are literate. Look, these data are discrete data, separated data, no separate meaning. But as soon as we summarize these two data, then we come to a conclusion that village rate of women literacy in village B is higher than village A. And it is 10% higher than B. So, and again, summation of many bits of information is knowledge. A person who has this kind of literary knowledge, rate of literacy knowledge of a particular district or state or he has a knowledgeable person. And a person who, with the basis of all these kinds of knowledge, a person who can give solution to the problem is a person which is with wisdom. So this is data, and in conducting research, we collect data that may be directly from the field, or many a time collection of data is derived from the samples, and sample must have to be the character to represent the universe of population. So in every research, data is collected, data is processed, and new knowledge is developed. And ultimate aim of research is to generate knowledge, to enrich the universe of knowledge domain. So that is important is research. For conducting the research, systematic steps must be followed. Let us, in a nutshell, look what are those systematic steps. Understanding the nature of the problem to be studied. So knowing the problem's nature is half work done. So unless and until we understand the nature of the problem or what is the problem we are going to address, it would not be able to us to find the solution. Then identify the related area of study, that is the peripheral area. That is also again important. So what others have done in the nearby areas, nearby problem, that has to be had an idea to develop research methodology. So identifying the related area of study is also important. Then review of literature to understand the others' approach to the problem. Because what others, previous scholars, what previous academician has done on this particular area, that is called review of literature. That is important because to understand the problem, to limit the problem, as well as to develop research methodology. Then collecting of data in an organized and controlled manner. and analysis and interpretation of data and drawing conclusion and making its generalization. So that is the systematic steps in research. And obviously in every research, there must be some criteria of good research. Then in any good research, purpose must be clearly defined. You know, for what purpose the research is being conducted? On what problem we are going to address? What is the statement of problem? And what are the hypotheses we are going to justify on the basis of research? That must clearly be identified. Then research process must be detailed. That is the how data are collected, how data are analyzed, what methodology we have followed. That is the research process. And research design must be thoroughly planned. High ethical standard. That is another important concept. Because ethics is the approach to the morality. So ethics in respect of the researcher, in respect of the research guide, in respect of the publisher, in all respects, and obviously the country, particularly dealing with those who are conducting research with living being. Country's research standard must be followed. And obviously limitation must frankly be revealed. Limitation in two sense. Somebody used to tell it as delimitation. There is difference between limitation and delimitation. Delimitation is self-imposed limitation. It is generally on two aspects mainly. There may be other aspects too. Those two aspects are delimitation in respect of time and delimitation in respect of geographical coverage. And adequate analysis data must be sufficiently represented. And finding must be clearly represented, as well as conclusion should be well justified so that a generalized result is found. For conducting literature review is also an essential component. It is done mainly to avoid duplication of research. If literature review is not done, if trend of research is not analyzed, then it is not possible for a researcher to conduct research, because after 1 or 2 years work, if he or she come to know that this is a duplication effort, so time is money. So all his efforts will be made. Identify variables that may influence the problem, variable in many respects. Identify methodology, limit the problem. And to know the trend of research, that is another important concept. Let me give you an example. Indian Association of Indian University published University News. So at the end of the University News, one can observe, one scholar can see that list of theses, subject-wise list of theses submitted to different Indian universities. So if one person take the issues of University News and jot down all the theses submitted on a particular subject of 1 year or say 2 years, obviously through analysis those theses, he can easily identify the trend of research and which domain is being important in this area of research, or which is a thrust area of research, and obviously define the area of study, the research topic. Now, I shall try to come to my main presentation concept, that is the research output. For conducting research, one object is to get a degree, that is the basic thing. But to obtain a degree, almost all the Indian universities have a prerequisite before submission of the thesis. One of those prerequisites are publication of research output in journal publication. So those are primary source of information. Why this is primary source? Because those articles published in academic journals or conference papers as a first time publication, not published elsewhere. So in most of the universities has given guideline that one scholar have had to publish at least two journal articles. Then secondary source of information, and finally web sources. So two important components one research scholar have had to publish: journal article, and ultimately he or she has to submit his thesis for getting the PhD degree. Now, let us see what are the parts of a scientific research. First of all, title. Title of scholar's article. Titles may or may not follow by a subtitle. In between title and subtitle, a colon is given. Subtitle is given to elaborate the title, to compensate the title, or to narrow down the title. Just let me give you an example. Rabindra Sangeet, Songs of Rabindranath Tagore, colon, a bibliometric study. So Rabindra Sangeet, Songs of Rabindranath Tagore is the title. Colon, a bibliometric study. A bibliometric study is the subtitle. So this subtitle narrows down the main title, Rabindra Sangeet, Songs of Rabindranath Tagore, as it deals with only the bibliometric approach, that is the application of statistics on literary warrant on this topic. So that is the subtitle. Then in a journal article comes author or author's name. There may be one author, two author, or more than two author. The first author is generally principal author or corresponding author. The second or third author, yeah. Now there is a concept of UGC API score, no? That is more important for many scholars, no? So, and again, API calculation, API score on journal publication, country, I mean, Indian or foreign journals varies from time to time on the basis of UGC's guideline. But now the latest circular is, if 15 marks is given for a journal publication, the first author, if he or she is principal author, generally so, or the corresponding author, gets 60% of API score. Remaining 40% is equally distributed. So out of 15, 9 marks gets the principal author, and remaining six months, each and every contributor gets it. So that is the author's name, and obviously author's affiliation. Many a times scholars contact research from fund given by different authorities. So, or he or she must be tagged with any university, any department or like that. So affiliation means the contributors, the scholars, the authors, affiliation with an university, with a research lab, with an institution, etc. Then comes the abstract. Abstract, generally 200 to 350 words abstract is derived, and within abstract, one or two general statements followed by the methodology the scholar have followed and finding and conclusion should be included. And then comes keywords, 5 to 7 keywords given at the after abstract. So only going through abstract and keywords, a scholar, a person, decides whether he or she should read the entire article or not, whether it falls under his domain of research, whether he or she is interested about it. So abstract and keywords are most important in this segment. Again, let me give the same example. So Rabindra Sangeet, Songs of Rabindranath Tagore, a bibliometric study. The keywords here are Tagoreana. Tagoreana means all the intellectual output of Rabindranath Tagore, Rabindra Sangeet, the Songs of Rabindranath, and Gaan. Then Shorobitan, the book of notation of Rabindranath, and obviously Danston. These 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are the keywords or descriptors used in this article. Then comes introduction. In introductory part, one just briefly introduce these concepts. And obviously, after introduction, a review of literature. So what previous works has done on this particular issue, then objectives of the study and hypothesis is given. What are the purpose of objectives of the study? Again, it is maybe 3 or 4 objectives that researchers wish to fulfill with this article, and obviously methodology, what methodology the researcher follows for collecting data, whether it is a single methodology of an interview, whether it is a dual methodology through literary survey as well as field survey. So one has every liberty, or one has to follow the methodology he or she followed for conducting his journal article. And then the analysis and interpretation of data, and discussion obviously in discussion part, comparison with others' works may also come, his new findings may come, and ultimately the conclusion and notes and references given at the end. Definition of technical terms may be given at the end. Limitation and should again be mentioned within the article itself. Many a times within introduction in the last 2-3 lines, limitation is mentioned, or otherwise one can mention limitation after a methodology. Now, but while submitting research paper for publication, one have had to must keep in mind that economy of words is important concept, because it shouldn't be repetition of same thing as one has given in introduction and same thing is being repeated in discussion. That should be avoided. I mean, business like sentence is important, and each sentence should have its own credibility. Now, ultimately, one has to submit a research paper for publication. Now, let us see what are the process of paper submission. First of all, my humble request to you, the scholars, that first of all, the journal in which one is planning to submit his paper, he or she should read few issues of that article so that he or she can estimate, judge himself or herself, whether he is at par with that journal standard, whether his area of research falls under the domain of that particular journal, and whether he or she agrees with the terms and conditions laid in the guidelines to contributor or notes to contributor of that particular journal. Generally, guidelines to contributor or notes to contributor is given at the beginning or at the end of journal. Sometimes it is given at the beginning of issues, of a new issue. I think my scholars obviously known, it is familiar to them, there is difference between volume and number. Okay, volume 50, number one. Volume 50 means the journal is being published through 50 years. And number means if it is published quarterly. That is, suppose January, April, August, and likewise. So number one means 50th year's publication, first issue means January. So there is difference between volume and number. All of you must have an idea about it. Still, I am mentioning it because it is important for citation of journal articles at the end of your article. Now, original article not submitted elsewhere for consideration within scope and coverage of the journal. First of all, I mentioned that one have had to read few issues to identify his position, to judge himself, his capacity, or he is at par with that journal standard and coverage of the journal. The article submitted in a journal must be original in nature and it should not be submitted elsewhere. Many a time through our practical experience, we have observed that journal, one person has submitted his article in a journal A. Later on, it takes time, obviously, for submission and its ultimate publication, time lag is there. If time lag is large, so 6 months or 8 months, then being added, the scholar submit the article to another journal. This shouldn't be done. If you wish to withdraw, you have every right to withdraw your article. Then if the scholar plans to submit it to another journal, then he or she should withdraw his first submission in writing. That, please allow me to withdraw my submission on such on this topic. Then he is free to submit it to other journal. Then designation and affiliation of the contributors, I mentioned it earlier. Then contract address of the contributors. This address must be his institutional address, because what research we have done is at the cost of institution and at the time of institutional. So it is our also responsibility to afford our institution. An informative abstract. I mentioned that about the abstract. I can read some abstract through examples, but time is short, that is not possible. And citation style. Look, there are different citation style of citing references. Suppose APA, MLA, Chicago Manual. But how can develop or journal can have their in-house citation style? I'm mentioning it's in-house citation style. For example, Nishkya, I mean, CSIR, Government of India publication, they have their own citation style. So that they mention their own citation style in the guide to contributors. So one after submit, before submitting a journal article, scholars, faculties must have aware about the citation style they follow, because a reputed journal throughout its publication follows a uniform citation style with specific citation guidelines. Then research paper submission. This is the awareness. So far I have discussed the awareness part about the contributor. Now the submission part comes. So before submission, references must be given in the text of the paper. References may be given within square bracket, or it may be superscript. That depends upon the citation style the scholar or the journal follows for citing the references. And at the end of the paper, on notes and references, the citation pattern, if it is square bracket, that means if one scholar follows APA style, then alphabetically authors surname according to alphabetical order may be given. Then if it is superscript following other style, numerical number linking it with the body of the letter should be given. Those things are important. And again, before submission, authors should also be aware about the copyright of his paper, whether he or she is surrendering his copyright, or it is open general copyright, or something like that. Nowadays, the submission is being done through online submission. In online submission, obviously, journal must have a website. One person, one scholar who is intended to submit his journal article must register there with his email address, and obviously a password will be generated. And in the submission module, one can have to submit or upload his, it have 3-4 steps generally. For example, in the first window, one has to write his journal title, then keywords, then abstract, then he has to upload his full file for submission. 3-4 steps to submit. After submission, originally, ultimately machine generated acceptance letter will be forwarded to the scholar's mailbox. And obviously the editor, after receiving it, the next step sent for review. Other comments one can follow opening the journal website and using his or her password. After submission, what steps the editor follows after submission? Obviously, for journal, there is an editorial board of scholarly persons. Besides editorial board, there is a good list of reviewers, because reviewers are domain experts. So after receiving the article, the chief editor allot an ODI number to that article and sends it to referee. I mean, the resource person, expert on that area. It is sent without mentioning the contributor's name. Generally, they block the contributor's name and his affiliation. And it is sent to the reviewer for review. Obviously, for reviewer, there are certain guidelines. Whether he or she accepted it, whether he or she rejected it, or asks for modification. If it is directly accepted, then no problem. If reject, then it obviously doesn't match with it, or there is difference between methodology and implication. Maybe it's repetition, or asks for modification. So if the asks for modification, it is done, it is sent to the scholar, then he or she has to comply with those modification. Modification may be in data calculation, maybe data tabulation, maybe insufficient of data, maybe findings and more narration regarding findings is essential, maybe objectives has been enlarged, it should be, it will be maybe reduced or something like that. And after this, those modification, the scholars may again resubmit it to the edit journal for reconsideration. Again, that may be accepted, or that may again be sent for our modification. Again, scholar have to comply. So this is the first part of research output, publication of journal article. My humble submission is that even Nobel laureate scholars journal article has also been rejected. So nobody should be disappointed or leave the field of writing if any article is rejected, because that is natural. It is rejected not only for the scholar's fault, not only for the methodology, but sometimes may be rejected due to journal's policy. For senior scholars, my submission is again that before submission, one can have an idea about that impact factor of that journal. So if he thinks that his writings, his articles are of that standard, then he or she should again consult the impact factor of that journal. It's a ratio. It's a calculation on the basis of which impact factor is derived. So that is another component one should keep in mind. And again, if the journal is delayed, if they send it for modification, if they send due to some plagiarism checkup or any other reason, author has every right to withdraw it. Withdraw it and disagree with the experts. I have that kind of experience too in my submissions in some renowned international journals. Now I'm coming to my second component of research output, which is most important, and for the scholars, those who are particularly for the hello? Okay, can you listen to me? Okay. Particularly for the new scholar, those who are planning to submit the thesis. Okay. Because that is ultimate object to get a degree, PhD. So parts of thesis generally three parts. Preliminaries, body or text, and appendices. In my presentation about thesis, I shall try to give an uniform pattern of submission, uniform pattern of chapterization. But please remember that it will vary, and it will vary, obviously it will vary from title to title, from problem to problem. Now let me come to cover preliminaries, that is a cover page. Cover page consists of the title, name of the scholar, PhD year, institution emblem, and institution name. Title, that means if it is a copyright of Tagore or not. If the title is Intellectual Output of Rabindranath Tagore, a study. That is, if it is a title, then name of the scholar should be given there. Then is PhD degree, PhD year. Then institutional emblem, it is Vishwavarti. Then Vishwavarti emblem and institutional name must be given in the cover page. After cover page comes the title page. Again, in the title page, title of the thesis must be given. And here I from my experience, I can say that please be careful. The title you have registered in your university for PhD degree must be in total must be in toto given in the cover page and title page without eliminating any comma, full stop, or anything else. So title page, in the title page, title must be given, then candidate's name, I mean the scholar's name, and then the statement. Statement means in partial full statement like that, that in partial fulfillment of the requirement for the award of the degree of philosophy in library and information science, thesis is being submitted, and the year of submission. Next page comes dedication. Next page, dedication, obviously it's optional. Many times we wish to dedicate it to our parents, to our teachers, even to somebody else. Then comes a declaration. The declaration part, an uniform standard generally followed. When things should be incorporated in the declaration, that it is the first time produced, not submitted for elsewhere for any award or degree, and it is a first time ideas, first time invention, first time research, submitting for consideration. Then certificates, certificate of the supervisor or supervisors. If there are two supervisors, I mean co-supervisors there, because nowadays research is being multidisciplinary approach. So supervisor from different discipline may be act as a co-supervisor. In that certificate, signature of both the co-supervisor should be incorporated. Well, again, it's as a standard form, particularly regarding originality of the thesis. It must be mentioned there that this thesis is original and worthy to be awarded for a PhD degree. Then the preface for and ultimately acknowledgement. Concept is acknowledgement in gratitude for help in conducting research supervisor, other faculty members, library or laboratory. The acknowledgement is being done. Obviously also to family members. Now, let me have an idea about preliminaries. Preliminaries, abstract or synopsis, content of the thesis should be cover page. Background and objective, hypothesis, finding and significance and implications of the finding should be included in the abstract or synopsis. Then table of contents, list of tables, list of figures, list of abbreviation, and list of players is also included in the preliminaries. Now we come to the body or text of the thesis. I'm submitting it for your consideration, 5 chapters. Please remember that chapters may vary depending upon the title of thesis. But generally, 5 chapters must be there. Chapter 1 is introduction, chapter 2 is literature review, chapter 3 is material and methods, chapter 4 result and discussion, and chapter 5 findings and conclusion. Now, chapter 1. In every chapter, I tried component and one conclusion component in every chapter. So, the chapter 1 introduction, what the scholar is doing about. Chapter 1 deals what the scholar is doing about. It should be narrated in the chapter 1. First of all, introduction. The author introduced his title to the audience, introduced the title to the examiner. So, brief narration of the introduction of the title, then statement of the problem, that is the exact title of thesis one is going on it. Then definitional analysis. If 3 or 4 terms used within the title, within the statement of problem, that may or may not be familiar, or your interpretation may vary from others, that including those ideas, definitional analysis should be given after statement of problem. Then objectives of the study. What are the objectives of the study? Then comes the research question. So many a times, instead of research question or instead of objectives, hypothesis is given. The hypothesis means some assumptions before conducting the research. After fulfilling it, it may be positive, that is, in the conclusion part, you may substantiate that your hypothesis is right, or one author, a scholar has every right to say it is negative, null, negative or null hypothesis. So objectives of study or research question or hypothesis, it depends. In generally in social science, particularly in education, hypotheses are included there. Now, need and significance of the study, why the research is being conducted? What the academic community, what the universe of knowledge, what the knowledge domain will be benefited from this research? That is 1.6, need and significance of the study. And conspectus. Conspectus means chapters. Many theses, the conspectus component is not given, but my humble suggestion to give this conspectus means chapterization, that is chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, etc. Because just going through the introductory chapter, that your examiner or the reviewer will automatically have an idea about the following chapters. So chapterization may also be given in the introductory chapter as 1.7 in the form of conspectus, and then come notes and references. Now the chapter two is generally a review of literature. That is what is known and what is unknown. What is known is important to develop research strategy, to develop research methodology, to identify your research area, to acknowledge that trend of research or domain of research. And what is unknown is also comes through literature review, that will strengthen the research area, that will strengthen the domain, unknown domain on which the scholar is conducting thesis, conducting research. Here again, 2.1, in every chapter I developed introduction and conclusion. Here also again 2.1 means first facet of chapter 2 is introduction. In this introductory part, what is literature, what is literature review, what are the advantages of literature review, what are the disadvantages of literature review, why literature review is being conducted, etc. may be mentioned in the introductory part. At the same time, what kind of documents the scholar has consulted for conducting literature also comes in the introductory part. For example, whether he has consulted both micro and macro document, I mean books and journals, and also web resources, those are comes under the introductory part of literature review. Second, the documents the scholars reviewed. For example, in my presentation, it started with macro document, I mean book, 252 is book. In that case, the surname of the author, that is the book which the scholar is review come first, then within bracket year of publication. For example, if it is Parthaprotim Ray, then Ray, year of publication of that books. Then the nutshell, the about review about the book. That means what the book is about, what is its finding, and what are its conclusion. Generally about the books on the dust cover or jacket of the books, and on one side about the book and about the author in the recto and verso of the jacket, one can observe. So about the books, from about the books, one can have a basic idea about the books for review. Then he has to go through the content to know the chapters after preface, and if necessary, one may or if directly falls under preview of his area of research, one may have to consult the entire document for review. Journal articles, same process, author's name, and year of publication, and then journal in the text, then web resources, what website address must be given here, and date of access is also an important. And ultimately comes conclusion. In the conclusion part, it is generally written that this area has been covered in the area in which the scholar is planning to submit or planning to conduct his research has not been covered by other scholars, or this is not been published or touched. It's an uncultivated land. That's why the scholar is selected this topic for our consultation for conducting research as a topic, and ultimately notes and references comes at the end of chapter 2. Now, chapter 3 is methodology, I mean research methodology. That is, there are different methods in research, that is the conducting research. It may be quantitative method, it may be qualitative method. Again, it may be there may be different methods of collecting data, whether it is questionnaire, whether it is interview, whether it is participant observation, or so that or scholar may follow a combination of different research methods in his research. For example, if somebody want to observe the Santal population and function and festivals, their culture. So for this, if anybody prepares a lengthy questionnaire and asks them, please come, I will interview, they may not come. Or they may not open their mouth before you. In that case, one scholar have had to be one among them. You have to go there in their villages or their community and observe these things and record those things. So observation methods can also be followed. Hello will depend ultimately that title of research. So in chapter 3, research methodology, what the research scholar is going to discover. What the research scholar is going to discover, the ultimate aim of chapter 3 is this. Again here must be there is an introduction. For example, introduction must include what is research, what are the methodology, what are the different research methods, what those comes under introduction. Then research methodology, that is the what methodology the scholar has followed for conducting research, must be mentioned there. And then come sources, source of documents mentioned, and the limitation and delimitation of the study. I have earlier mentioned that every study must have some delimitation and delimitation. For example, if somebody conducts research on agriculture, paddy production. This can be a research title because paddy production of which area? Is it paddy production of Bengal? Production of Birbhum? So one has to limit the title paddy production of Birbhum. This is Birbhum is limitation. Limitation in respect of geographical coverage. Again, time frame must be there. Is paddy production of Birbhum throughout the ages? No, it is again through some period. For example, paddy production in Birbhum district. 2010 to 2020. So these are the called limitation. One has to limit his or her thesis through this geographic limitation as well as time frame limitation. Obviously, some other limitation regarding sample, regarding population, one can impose. Obviously, all limitation must be justifiable. And the citation style. Citation style means what citation pattern one has followed in his entire thesis, whether APA, whether ALA, whether Chicago, or he or she developed his own style. In that case, one scholar may give citation with two examples. His own example can also be cited. His own example of publication may also be cited. That is also proof that scholar has submitted or published at least 2-3 articles. One his own journal article and another, maybe if it is macro document, his book if it is there. So his own citation may be given. And at the end, again comes notes and references. Notes and references is again important. And chapter 4, that is the result and discussion. What the scholars have found. Now we are coming to the end. What the scholar have found and what does it mean? So, what the scholar have found and what does it mean? It is important. Again, here it is. There must be an introduction. And second 4.2, I mean chapter 2, second component result, actual statement of observation, including statistical gaps, data, both negative and positive results should be mentioned. So here after introduction result, which is nothing but data analysis and interpretation of data under result. So actual statement or actual findings, including statistical tables, including data, one scholar derived graphical representation, both negative and positive points. This is also important. Both negative and positive points must be mentioned in the result with substantive references. That is also important. Then comes discussion. discussion, the purpose of discussion is not to retreat the findings, what findings we are getting, that will come under in the final chapter, that is chapter 5. That is, it is in the discussion, that shouldn't be repeated here. But to discuss observation with theoretical body of knowledge of the subject. Here, what the scholar observed with theoretical body of knowledge and implication of findings, for generalize, what are the possibilities of generalizing his ideas for future generation references is important in this discussion. So in discussion under result and discussion, please note that findings, which is an integral part of chapter 5 and in the final chapter, shouldn't come here. Only discussion about the article, about the thesis, and researchers' observation on the basis of his total theoretical knowledge, on the basis, that means on the basis of literature review, on the basis of his experience during sample collection, on the basis of his interaction, come under this area. And what are these, the implication of these findings comes, and ultimately the conclusion and notes and reference of chapter four. Then comes chapter 5, that is a summary and conclusion. What are the possible applications of findings? While writing summary and conclusion as chapter 5 in thesis, what points should keep in mind by the scholars? Those are, what are the possible application of findings? Application does it make to the domain of knowledge? And what next? What next means, is there any suggestion for the study? In chapter 5, that is the introductory part, summary, few sentences to summarize the most important result and its general application. Please remember, in this summary, also the discussion part in the previous chapter will not come. Only in few sentences one have to mention the results. Results as one derived in chapter 4, result that will come, and its general applications, just few sentences, and conclusion. Conclusion means the strongest and most important statement that the scholar wishes to highlight about the outcome of his research. Conclusion, again, I'm repeating, the strongest and most important statement, find it some statement that highlights outcome of the research, answers to the question raised in the introductory chapter. That is, please remember, in the introductory chapter, we have mentioned statement of the problem, or in some thesis we mentioned hypothesis. Here, that is the time one is satisfying the question raised in chapter 1 with is summary, 5.2, second passage of chapter 2, and conclusion. He or she has to answer those questions and recommendation for further study. Because during this study, authors, during his own study, the scholars may observe there are some more areas of studies which can substantiate this his research. There are more areas of studies, there are more areas, peripheral areas, uncontributed in and around this study. Yes or C can recommend those areas for further study and ultimately notes and references. Now comes the bibliography and reference part of the thesis. Please remember, many a time we mix up bibliography and references. Obviously, there is difference between bibliography and reference. Bibliography is the list of all the materials that have been consulted while writing an article or a book. So bibliography is the sum total of all documents the scholar have studied during his research. So that is the broad canvas. Remember, that is the broad canvas of study. And references, on the other hand, are those that have been referred in an article or in a thesis. So one may have studied 100 books that will come under bibliography, but he or she is referring only 10 books in references. So in references will come only those 10 books. So broader canvas is the 100 books, and 10 books are the references. That is, your draw the picture on the canvas. This is the basic difference. So again, in citing or writing bibliography, there are differences too. For references are directly cited in the text, bibliography is not cited in the text. That is very important. Bibliography is not cited in the text. In the text, either within square bracket or within first bracket or within superscript 1, 2, 3 or within first bracket, putting the author's surname and year of publication and relating with this at the end, that notes and references giving at the end is done. This is reference. But in case of bibliography, no such citation directly with the body of text is done. References can use to support the statement of argument. Bibliography does not have such kind of role. So references is within quote. Within quotation, reference is used to support, oppose, or thesis, synthesis, or antithesis of an statement. So that is the basic difference. Obviously, both bibliography and reference, there are some common things also. What are those? Basically, both bibliography and reference appear at the end of the document, but bibliography comes after the reference, because reference is most important in this particular research, particular article. Bibliography may component all that have been appeared in the reference, but reserve it not. I'm repeating, please remember. Bibliography may contain all that have been appeared in the reference. So all the articles that in my example, 10 articles, 10, you have studied 100 things, books or journal article, as reference you are putting 10. Those 10 will come as bibliography, but all the bibliographical parts, I mean all the remaining 90 will not come under reference. That is the important things. Bibliographies are arranged alphabetically generally, but reference are arranged alphabetically or numerically, or that is following a citation style. That is important. So again, I'm repeating, bibliographies are arranged alphabetically according to author's surname, sign, post, then R, A to Z format. But bibliography may be followed alphabetical order if the style is APA, American Psychological Association style, or maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, just numerically if other styles are followed. Now, this is another important concept is citation. After each and every article, we have had give them references. Those references are citation. Citations are the references giving at the end or within the text of scholarly papers and in the footnotes to the articles or document previously. So citation are the references that one is given at the end of an article or within the body. So that is important. A paper is cited in paper points out that it is an important and there is some relation between the two. So citation must have some kind of relationship with the article, with the thesis, with the area on which one is conducting research. That relationship may substantiate the article, may substantiate the thesis, or may not, but it should be there. If it is synthesis or antithesis, both in both the cases, the citation must have some kind of relationship. Then why citation? Why we are bothering to give citation? Here the ultimate question is towards ethical question, or ethics, that is the approach to morality. Actually, it is nothing but paying homage to the pioneers. Our previous scholars has reached the knowledge up to a certain level. After that level, you or the scholars of present generation is conducting research to reach it to a newer height. So we must have acknowledge, must pay homage to our pioneers, and we must give credit to the related works. Because without studying, without giving to the related works, without paying homage to our pioneers, our review of literature is not possible. Without review of literature, it may not be possible to develop my search strategy. It may not be possible to frame the limitation or delimitation. May not possible even to identify the thrust area of research. Again, I mentioned earlier, that citation is giving necessary for identifying methodology, I mentioned, providing background reading. It also gives them background knowledge of the entire, not to the pinpointed, not only the pinpointed area of study, the area of research one is conducting, but the broader perspective. And obviously, for criticizing previous area, previous work, to say that you are doing, the scholar is doing something new, which previous procedures have not done. This is a new area which nobody has touched. This is the virgin land to identify trend of research, etc. The citation is necessary. One scholar questioned me about citation style. Look, there are different citation style for humanities, the MLA handbook for writers of research papers, Modern Language Association of America, for social science, APA, American Psychological Association, multiple style for multiple size, Chicago manual is there. For chemistry, subject-specific citation style is also there. For chemistry, ACS, American Chemical Society style is there. For physics, AIP, American Institute of Physics style, also follows. And in my previous statement, I mentioned the house can develop. Journal house can develop their in-house citation styles too, like NASA Institute of Science Communication and Information Resources, CSIR style. Citation style reference management software are also there. I have given some references of citation management style. Actually, in every citation, there are some basic components. What are those basic components? Basic components are author's name, in case of author's name, then the title, in case of books I am talking about. Author's name, title of the book, title or subtitle, title of the book, then publisher, then place of publication, then year of publication, and pagination. These are important area for, important facets for bibliography. I am repeating, for book, author's name, author again, maybe one, two, three, multiple author is also possible. Author name, then title of the document, then publisher, then year of publication, then publishing place of publication, and pagination. These are essential facets for book. Again, for journal, the contributors, I mean author's name, the name of the journal, the article name, volume and number and pagination. Volume, number and pagination. Regarding pagination, let me give you an example. If somebody writes 51, then small p dot. That means he's referring not a particular page, he's referring page number 1 to 51. I'm repeating. If somebody writes 51, then p dot, that means he is repeating page number 1 to 51. All the pages, 51 pages he is repeating. But if somebody writes p dot 51, in that case, he is referring a particular page, the 51th page he is referring. So that is again important while I will prepare your citation style. So there are certain reference management softwares also, which I've given some references, and it is possible in through this software style of one style to another style, because in please remember, in every style the facet I have earlier mentioned for books and journals are the same. I've given an example. Let me give you an example. For example, APA style, the author's surname first, comma, then first and second name, and then year of publication comes within first page. I'm repeating, in APA, American Psychological style, author's surname first, if it is Ray, R-A-Y, my name, Partho Pratim Ray, if it is Partho Pratim Ray, then Ray, R-A-Y, comma, then P and P, Partho P, and again P from Pratim, P dot, and if the book is published in the year 2012, then 2012 will come in first packet, then again dot. This is the first component, and in according to APA style. But look, in Chicago style, the same thing will come in different composition. The surname Ray dot Partho, look, Partho dot P, and then year of publication 2040. First bracket is not given here. My intention is, and it is not possible for me to show or give citation, give example of all the citation styles, but my humble submission is that in every cases, the basic facets are the same. The arrangement of the facets, I mean author, title, publisher, place of publication, or year of publication, in case of journal, journal's name, article's name, volume and number, and pagination just varies. I am going to on the verge of my presentation, but in conclusion, I am planning to mention one thing, that now there are different software which can test your plagiarism. That is an important complex concept. In other sessions, respected scholars will deliver on each. But one should be, while submitting thesis or submitting paper, one should be very, very careful that it should pass through a plagiarism check. And nowadays, librarians have been entrusted with the responsibility for this check without including the certificate that it has been passed through plagiarism check. The thesis is not possible to submit thesis nowadays, and it will be more strict in the near future. Again, in case of submitting journal art papers for journal publication, the reputable journals also checks it through different plagiarism software like Urkun and other things. That is important. And I have another request that, and now we know we shall follow with the interactive session. My expectation from you is that let it not be a one-way traffic, but let be a two-way communication, so that I can interact, I can respond to some of your question. In the presentation, it will be later on uploaded in YouTube tube of Central Library. So next any time you can access to this presentation. Obviously, my email and phone numbers are also there. You are always welcome for with any clarification or any suggestion. At the end, I wish to make you a request. Request is. Due to this pandemic, my humble request is please stay at home, stay safe, and help the warriors like doctors and other medical professionals, police and security personnel to fight against this pandemic called Corona. And finally, another request, keep your face always towards the sunshine, and shadows will fall behind it. It should be the thumb rule of thesis, thumb rule of academic honesty. Thankful receivers as you bear a plentiful harvest. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much, Patoda, for your deliberation regarding thesis output and how we present our thesis. I think. Our research scholars benefited from the presentation of Patoda Patindra, and now we are going to open for the discussion.
Hello, this is Prashant. Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Hello, this is Prashant.
Yes, please, Prashant. Prashant, carry on.
Hello. You may ask the
question. Due to noise, I couldn't hear anything.
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
এই এত চেঁচামেচি করবে না এরা
Please, please carry on.
Ibo, আমি দেখতে গান দেই কিন্তু
কে
Hello.
Now I'm requesting you all participants, if you have any questions, you may ask or you may send the send your question in the chat box or you can directly email to Parthoda. So I'm opening the house for the discussion.
Hello. Sujit, I have a question.
Yes. Yes, please, carry on.
Yes, please raise your question.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Ask the question.
No. Hello.
Hello.
Parthoda, this is Roshan. Can you hear me?
Please continue. Yes, I am listening. Hello, Roshan. Carry on.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Parthoda. Can you hear me? Basha Baba.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. I want to ask about
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Tell me, sir.
Please continue.
Sir, you just told there is a difference between delimitation and limitation. Should I write delimitation / limitation in my thesis?
No, one should give only one component, that is limitation. Actually, there is a very keen difference between limitation and delimitation. In most of it is just, I discussed it just for technical discussion. Most of the cases, it is limitation. Give limitation, oblique delimitation. Okay.
Hello.
You should write only limitation, not limitation, oblique delimitation.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any more question?
Hello, this is Roshanjit Patoda.
Hello.
Hello.
sir. How to identify literary publishers, sir? Sir, how to identify literary publishers?
Okay, I'm trying. There is a question, how to identify big publisher, literary publisher. Actually, it has been made compulsory by the UGC to raise API score for CAS, career and probation scheme, career assessment schemes. In that case, to get just API marks, a good, huge number of publication panel scheme in the market. Most of them doesn't have history, but they got ISS number. It is another important concept. ISS mean international standard serial number. So they got international standard serial number and started publication. And UGC on a certain point of time asked the publishers to submit a list. Discarded 80% journals. If one go to UGC's website, you will find list of journals approved by UGC. This is, I think, the first source to unauthorized journal. We take it from UGC websites. In every subject, there are certain classic journals recognized globally. One should know that those journals of his area of research or research. Thank you.
I have a question, Patoda.
Please.
In chapter introduction part, in me.
Chapter 1 introduction part,
introduction part. Yes.
Sorry, I couldn't listen.
Clear me about conflict.
Clear about? Clear about?
Darling,
clear about what? That's okay then. Okay then, I'm coming. I'm coming. Actually, in my organization of thesis, chapter 1 is introduction. In introduction, I mentioned a component as 1.7, that is 7 facets of chapter 1, and conspectus. Conspectus is nothing but chapterization. So under the 1.7 conspectus, one could write that this thesis is divided in the following chapters. Chapter 1, introduction. Chapter 2, review of literature. Chapter 3, research methodology, and so on and so forth. So that we before going to the remaining chapters, the examiner or the person who is reviewing the thesis would have an idea about the chapterization of the scholars.
Oh.
But in many Indian theses, this part not included. But I prefer to include this.
Okay.
Compulsory component as well.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, is there any more questions? Any more questions from the party?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, please continue.
I have put a question on chat box. The subsections of introduction chapter.
Yeah.
Is it essential to organize those subsection as presented in the in the presentation?
Yeah. Actually, I tried to give a model. Okay, I tried to give a model. It is not compulsory that every thesis will strictly follow this model. For example, in my presentation, in every chapter, I try to give an introduction of that chapter. For example, chapter one, introduction of introductory chapter. So, and obviously a conclusion. But this is a general presentation. It may again vary from title to title, thesis to thesis, and even subject to subject. Example, here in my presentation, objectives of the study is given, and research question is given. One may not include research question or research question here. In place of research question, he may put hypothesis. Generally, in educational research thesis, it is given there. So it is not an uniform. I have divided the thesis in 5 chapters. It may again be divided into 10 chapters. For example, if somebody works on gender discrimination in Madhyayuga Kavya, if anybody works on gender discrimination in Madhyayuga Kavya, then gender discrimination in each kavya may be a separate chapter. Gender discrimination in Mongol kavya, gender discrimination in other kavyas. So it will depend up to the title and discipline.
Actually, so I wanted to know the sequence of the elements that you mentioned in the chapter one. 1.1 is introduction, 1.2 is statement of the problem.
Right, yes. Definitional analysis. Suppose if the title is so lucid that no definitional analysis is required, then this area may be omitted.
All those components are there, then that should be right in that sequence.
It is in this order. Then it should be in this order.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Is there any more question? You can send your mail through the chat or email. If there is no question, we need to wait. If you have question, please raise your question. So, thank you, Pathoda, and the nice presentation. Our scholars and the academicians are very this is very nice experience that we are connected with during this lockdown video conferencing. And I think we can organize interesting sessions like this. Your feedback will be encouraged us. The feedback forms after the last session. And choose only the question you have. So there are so many questions regarding the feedback form. So I claim to you, you can see the intended session. And all the people and presentation live will be available soon to your email. I'll send you the link and
thank you all.
So thank you very much. Now we are going to wind up the session.